So in the last several videos, we have thought about how glycogen is synthesized and broken down in times when either we need to store energy or to release that stored energy. And we talked about how the whole process is a branch off of glycolysis. So the idea here is we start with glucose, and we know that glucose can be converted irreversibly to the first intermediate of glycolysis, which is glucose 6-phosphate. And then from there are several more steps that break down glucose 6-phosphate into pyruvate in the glycolysis pathway. And we highlight this first intermediate, glucose 6-phosphate, because this is the branching point where we can break off and either create glycogen or glycogen breakdown ends up producing a glycolytic intermediate that can be used for energy. So the idea here is the first step is a reversible conversion of glucose 6-phosphate into glucose 1-phosphate, and this was using phosphoglucomutase. And then if we are converting glucose into glycogen, the next step was the irreversible conversion of glucose 1-phosphate into UDP glucose. Okay, and remember this consumes one equivalent of UTP and it produces this molecule pyrophosphate, which is two phosphates linked together. Okay, and then once we have UDP glucose, we can then use the enzyme glycogen synthase to convert the UDP glucose into glycogen. In this process, we also produce UDP, and this is catalyzed by the enzyme glycogen synthase. Okay, so this was the three-step process of converting a glycolytic intermediate, glucose 6-phosphate, into glycogen. Right? And we saw that the reversal of this process, or breaking down glycogen, is a two-step process, where the first step is the irreversible conversion of glycogen to glucose 1-phosphate using the enzyme glycogen phosphorylase. So in this video, our goal is to understand how this process, either the process of the synthesis of glycogen or the breakdown of glycogen, can be controlled by extracellular signals like insulin or glucagon. And to do so, we have to really focus in on the two enzymes, glycogen synthase and glycogen phosphorylase. These two enzymes are the two enzymes that are capable of receiving and responding to an extracellular signal that gets translated into the cell. And let's go ahead and explore how that happens. So what we're looking at here is the big picture of the regulatory strategy of glycogen synthesis or breakdown through triggering by insulin or glucagon. Okay, and we'll look at this in a little more detail in a second, but first, what I want you to notice is that there are several enzymes involved. Okay, and I want to take a minute to think about two big classes of enzymes that play a very large role in this. The first are enzymes called kinases. A kinase is an enzyme that catalyzes the phosphorylation of another enzyme or protein. Okay, so it transfers a phosphate from specifically ATP onto another enzyme. Okay, and in the process here, we make ADP. So kinases catalyze this reaction, the transfer of a phosphate from ATP onto a substrate protein. Okay, and what we're going to see in this scheme is that one form of this protein, either R or the phosphorylated version of R, is active or inactive. And this is a really common theme in your cells. When you phosphorylate an enzyme, oftentimes you influence its ability to function. Sometimes phosphorylating it will activate it, whereas sometimes it's the non-phosphorylated form that is active. So the kinase is the enzyme that puts the phosphate onto another protein. Conversely, a phosphatase catalyzes the hydrolysis of this phosphorylated product. So the phosphatase will start with the phosphorylated enzyme, and using water as a reactant, it will hydrolyze this back to an unphosphorylated protein and an inorganic phosphate. Okay, so the big picture here is kinases catalyze the phosphorylation process, whereas phosphatases catalyze the hydrolysis of that phosphate and convert the enzyme back to its unphosphorylated form. All right, so with that in mind, let's go ahead and transfer back now and look at this big picture and see how these two enzymes play a role. So let's go through and define what some of these acronyms mean. First, we see up top, we have PP1. So that stands for phosphoprotein phosphatase. This is a phosphatase that, remember, can catalyze the hydrolysis of phosphorylated proteins. What we'll note here is it's activated by insulin. We also have GS, which is glycogen synthase. This is an enzyme we've seen before. As the name suggests, it catalyzes the synthesis of glycogen. Next, we see PKA. This stands for protein kinase A. This is a really important enzyme in your cells. It's a kinase, so it uses ATP as a source of phosphate, and it will phosphorylate other enzymes. We note here that it's activated by cyclic AMP. Remember, cyclic AMP is a secondary messenger that's produced through signaling from glucagon. So protein kinase A is activated in response to signals from glucagon. Okay, protein kinase A will phosphorylate two different enzymes in this case, either glycogen synthase or this PHK is phosphorylase kinase. So phosphorylase kinase is a kinase that will then in turn put a phosphate group onto GP, which is glycogen phosphorylase. Okay, so glycogen phosphorylase is the enzyme we've seen that will catalyze the breakdown of glycogen. Okay, so lots of acronyms here, but each of them corresponds to an enzyme with a very distinct role. So to help us understand how insulin and glucagon can influence these different activities, let's go ahead and isolate just the influences that insulin has. By doing this, we can see that insulin initially activates our phosphoprotein phosphatase, and this has the effect of inactivating glycogen phosphorylase. Remember, glycogen phosphorylase is the enzyme that will break down glycogen. So insulin will turn off glycogen breakdown. The other thing that the active form of PP1 will do is activate glycogen synthase. So with glycogen synthase active, we have glycogen synthesis turned on. So through these signaling pathways, insulin has the effect of turning on glycogen synthesis and turning off glycogen breakdown. If we do the same thing for glucagon, we've talked about how glucagon will triggered the synthesis of cyclic AMP. And cyclic AMP is a secondary messenger that activates protein kinase A. With protein kinase A active, we get the active form of phosphorylase kinase, which will then in turn activate glycogen phosphorylase. That turns on glycogen breakdown. The other enzyme that protein kinase A will phosphorylate is glycogen synthase. But in this case, the phosphorylated version of glycogen synthase is inactive. And by inactivating this enzyme, we actually turn off glycogen synthesis. So glucagon has the overall impact of turning off glycogen synthesis, but turning on glycogen breakdown. So this ends up being a fairly straightforward regulatory strategy where two different hormones, insulin and glucagon, have opposite effects. Glucagon, which is synthesized in response to low blood sugar, leads to glycogen breakdown, therefore mobilization of sugar. Whereas insulin, which is secreted in response to high blood sugar, causes glycogen synthesis and prevents breaking down more glycogen.